jump right into the message tonight. Signs that you need new, like, let me see it again. How many of you need some new friends? You're like, listen, and like, you're sitting next to your friend. You're like, yeah, sorry. No, not sorry. Like, sorry, not sorry. You know what I'm saying? Like, you need some new friends. If you want to go ahead, Justin, and put that up, that first slide, you need some new friends. That's what we're going to talk about. Signs that you need new friends. How many of your friends would do that to you right there? If you fell asleep, they're like drawing things on you, writing things on you. Absolutely. So this is what we're going to do. Matt, if you could just turn me up just a little bit, that'd be great. Guys, this is what we're going to do. We're going to take a break from Exodus, and we're going to take a break. We've been preaching through Exodus, Moses' whole story. And this week, what we want to do is we want to talk a little bit about friendship. We need to talk about friends. We need to talk about, because listen, I'm like hanging out with you guys all the time. Some of you come right after school and hang out with you. Some of you I'm hanging out outside going to this, doing that, and all these different things. And I'm hearing a lot of talk about this friend, that friend, 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 friend. Like, what do I do? My friend's doing this. My friend's doing that. And like all of these friend things. So I was like, you know what? We're just going to do about 4 weeks. And we're just going to talk about friendship. We're going to talk about what it means to be a friend, what are friendships. And so what's going to be different about tonight, tonight's going to be a little bit more interactive than usual. You guys know if I bust out the whiteboard, it's going to get interactive. It's going to get a little bit more real on things. And so what I need your help tonight, because I need you. When you read or hear the word friend, what are words that you think of? Toy Story. That's a good one. We like some Toy Story. That's awesome. Toy Story. What are some other things? Yes. Pranks. Oh, man. Pranks. All right. Let's get Kessler. What do you got? Facebook. What are some other things we got that we can think of? Yes. Netflix. All right, how many of you share each other's Netflix account? Let's just be honest. No, I want to know. Sharing Netflix. All right, some of you. Emily, what do you got? What? What? Zero? Man, that is sad. Well, hey, we're just being honest. We're being real here. Yes?
Bad decisions.
Bad choices. We're going to talk a little bit about that. So we got some bad friends that we make. What else? What are some other things? Yes.
Shopping.
How many of you like to shop with your friends? All right, let's be real. How many of you like to eat with your friends? Yeah, praise them. Oh, yeah. We love to do that. We love to eat. Yeah, someone says, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I see that. See that. Thomas. Handshakes. How many of you have a handshake with a friend? All right, cool. Handshakes. All right. What are some other things? Yes. Shh, can't hear. Ride or die. Ride or die. Very good. Ride or die. That's a good one. I like that. James, what do you got? Loyal. Oh, that's good. I like that. I like it. Loyal. What else? Go ahead. What? Movies. Watching movies. How many of you watch movies with your friends, but all they do is talk during the movie? Yeah. For real, right? Yo, you better sit. They're ready to fight over here. They're ready to fight. All right, Sid, what do you got? Motivating. All right, yeah, we need some motivating friends. That's a good one. Motivating's good. All right, Mike, what do we got? Huh? 3 a.m. sheets run. We're calling that 3 a.m., baby. 3 a.m. Tori, what do you got? What?
Money.
Money? Oh, okay, it's one of those redneck things. Okay, cool. Money. I thought she said money. I was like, well, I'll be your friend. I'll be your friend. I could do that. So, hey, is the just real quick, is the lighting okay out there, Griff? The lighting. I don't need a clap. He's like, yes, you're doing such a good job. No, lighting. Is it okay? We're good. All right. All right, a few more. Olivia.
Zero personal space.
No personal space. We all have those friends. I'm going to write it like right here. No personal space. See, we're learning a lot of things. So people, Bethany, yes. How many of you got inside jokes with your friends? How many of you got outside jokes with your friends? You don't even know what that is. All right, inside jokes. All right, a couple more. Yes. So what would we call that? Near-death experiences. Death by friends. All right, what else do we got? We got lots of good stuff going. People, we're not putting names on the board. Yes. Food. Food's a good thing. We love food. All right. So we got a lot of great things going on here. Words you think of when I want people that have not given anything yet. Anybody else? Matt, what do you got? Good times and bad times. That's good. Good times, the good and the bad. Good and the bad. All right. Anything else? Yes, Angel. What? Food? Food's up there. We're good. What's because food is good? You guys don't know what shorthand is. What are you doing? All right, one more. Oh, what's yours is mine. Oh, we're going to call sharing. All right, listen. How many of you don't share? I don't share very well. I don't like to share things. All right, so. All right. Well, hey, guys, check this out. We have so many words that we correlate to friendships. And we have different types of friends. We have different types of people we're connected to. And, like, all of these are great words. They're words that connect us to friends, words that help us associate with friends. But I want to talk a little bit more about that because when we think of the word friend, there's many different avenues that we go. But dictionary.com or Webster's Dictionary that we know it as from when I was in school, it's a person that is attached by feelings of affection or personal regard, a person who gives assistance or supporter. And then they threw this in there just not too long ago, a person associated with another as a contact on social media, which we're going to talk a little bit about that. So we're going to talk about choosing the right friends because we need new friends. We need friends that are going to be the things that we want them to be and not to do these things that they've been doing to us. And so it's one of these things that we really have to really talk about. Check this verse out. This is an awesome verse in Proverbs. Go ahead and throw it up on the screen. It says, a man of many companions or friends may come to ruin, but there is a friend who sticks closer than a brother. This is such an awesome verse because we're going to break it down. The beginning part of this says, a man has many companions or friends. They're going to come to ruin. Well, that's encouraging. If you have a lot of friends, a lot of companions, well, it could happen, it's possible that you could come to ruin in what goes on. So you got to understand, Solomon, who wrote Proverbs, where this is found, was saying that a person, male or female, who has many friends could possibly be destroyed. Because the more people you're around, the more people influence you. The more things that you can kind of get caught up in that you don't really want to get caught up in. A couple reasons are, it takes a lot of work to be friends with many people. You learn this as you get older. You're like, man, I don't know if I want to be friends with all these people. They're needy. They're dramatic. They're a pain. They always want something. So you end up like cutting your friends down as you get older more and more and more, and you realize that. But I got four small points that I just jotted down real quick. I don't have them on the screen, but let me just kind of throw this at you. Number one is this. You don't have to be friends with everybody. You really don't. You got to be respectful and loving, but you don't have to be friends with everyone. Number two, people may not be bad or evil, but maybe they just aren't people you should be around. Can I just be honest? Like, they may not be bad or evil, but maybe they're just people you shouldn't be around because it's not good, it's not positive, it's not something that's uplifting for you. It's okay to have a small group of friends, number three. It's okay. More friends is more drama, more issues, more things that go on. If you have a small group of friends, that's cool, that's okay. And then number four is this, it's okay to be selective with what type of friends you have in your life. It's okay to be selective of that. And I'm at an age where I have friends that are younger than me and I have friends that are older than me. And it's crazy ends of the spectrum, crazy different lifestyles, crazy different people, but it's okay to be selective in who you choose to be your friend. See, when I was, even when we got married, everybody was my friend. I wanted everybody to be my friend. Oh, Bethany, be like, who's that? That's my friend. Who's that? That's my friend. Who's that? That's my friend. And as I matured in my walk with God and as I matured as a person, I realized I don't need all of those people. Because sometimes it just gets crazy. Now, what's interesting to me, let's back it up a little bit. Just because you have a lot of friends on Facebook or Twitter or Instagram, it doesn't really mean that they are a real friend. It means that they might just be following you. They might just like when you take a picture of your food every once in a while. They're just, because I'll tell you, they might not be there when times get rough. When you need someone, they might not be the ones that are there. And so we have to understand that. I kind of disagree with the dictionary definition of this, that that's what a friend is. Because it cannot be a friend. It could be someone that is someone that you shouldn't be talking to. It could be someone that is really doesn't, you know, is trying to harm you than help you. So we have to be very careful when we decide to divulge things on social media and on Facebook and on Instagram on who's our friend and who's not. So that's the first part of this verse. That a man of many companions may come to ruin, but the second part is, but a friend will stick closer than a brother. This takes the whole concept of friendship to a whole nother level because you're merging friendship and family. Because if you come from a family, even if it's not always the greatest family, they're your family. They're your blood. They're who you are. It's who you're proud to be. And so what this does is this actually is merging those concepts where some people who have friends, their friends are closer than their family. Let's be honest. Some of you in this room, your friends that are here are closer than your siblings. Maybe you have other people outside of here where you're closer to them than your cousins. That's how I was growing up. My friends were closer than a lot of the people that were in my life, even though they were family. But what it's saying here is there is a friend who will stick closer than a brother to you. And so here are three important things. When we start this series, we're talking about friendship. We're talking about these things that if these are signs that you may need some new friends. Number one is this. They ditch you. Isn't that a sad picture? It's like, oh, poor little box head weird thingy. Like, and if you actually like look very closely, he's got tears coming down his face. And I'm not sure if it's tears or rain, but one of the two. But listen, if you have friends that ditch you all the time, you need to get some new friends because let's just be honest, if they were a good friend, they wouldn't ditch you. And what do you mean ditch you? Well, I mean where they say, hey, let's go to the mall and hang out. You go to the mall and hang out, then they're not there. Or you go and you all hang out and they get a text message and they end up leaving you. I got to go to the bathroom. They really don't go to the bathroom. They run out, they get in the car and they go out with somebody else and hang out. There you are in the mall alone by yourself. How many of you know what I'm talking about? Like you understand what I'm saying. Where you've had friends who have ditched you, straight up ditched you for something better. Whether it was a friend, whether it was a place, whether it was a person. See, friends look out for each other and they prioritize their time. So anytime you're hanging out with a group of friends and suddenly they make plans to go do something else or they don't invite you along or they are being unkind to you or whatever, listen, these are signs that you need new friends because I'm going to tell you, and we talked about it, those friends aren't loyal. James said loyal. See, we got to understand loyalty is something unique that's hard to find in people today. We don't really use the term loyal much. Like, it's not really a term that comes up every day that we talk about. We talk about loyal. No. Can I tell you this? Loyalty is not a word. It's a lifestyle. Can I be honest with you? Loyalty, it is not a word. It's a lifestyle that you live throughout your whole life. Well, how do I know this? Because this is what it says in the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 4, verses 9 through 10. It says, two are better than one because they have a good return for their labor. If either of them falls down, one can help the other up. But pity anyone who falls and no one's there to help them up. So what this is saying is it's a good thing when someone, when you have someone that can pick you up when you fall down, or that you can pick up when they fall down. But pity the man, pity the person that has nobody, that has no friends to be there to help them when things go wrong. If you have friends that are ditching you all the time, you need to get better friends because they're obviously not loyal to them. But the other question is are you loyal to them, not are they loyal to you? Are you the one that ditches them? Are you the one that says, oh, I'm just looking for the next best thing to go around? Like, I understand. I remember being a teenager because you have that one friend you hang out with and you're like, I have a good time. But then you have that one friend you're like, we always have fun. You know what I'm talking about? Like, the one friend you're like, eh. The one friend you're like, eh, eh, eh. You know what I'm talking about? Like, you have those friends where you love to hang around that one person. And if they call you, it doesn't matter who you're hanging with. You're like, I'm going with them. I remember those days. I remember having those friends as a teenager where like, I'd rather hang with them than really hang out with this other person. I'm only hanging out with this other person because I had to get out of the house because they need something to do. Well, can I tell you, if that's you, you need to really recognize that being loyal is a two-way street. It has to go both ways. You have to be loyal and you have to expect loyalty from your friends. But I'll tell you this, here's a sign. If your friends begin to ditch you all the time for other things, for other people, you need to get new friends because you need friends that are going to be loyal to help you and be there. Number two, this is an interesting one. If your friends lie to you, if they lie to you, we got some problems. You know, and this was interesting because, like I said, a little interactive tonight. Is it okay to lie to your friend?
No.
Is it okay to lie to your friend?
No.
Yes, no. All right, let's take a vote. How many of you say absolutely not, it is not okay to lie to your friend? How many say that? All right, how many of you say it's okay to lie to your friend every once in a while? All right, because like, listen, let's just be honest. Like this whole lying thing, you know, we say this is how we are. Well, we're not gonna lie about the big important things, but the little things we may lie about a little bit, okay? Because sometimes it's okay if we just slip in that little white lie. You know, like as long as like this doesn't change the whole like life or legacy or generation of this person, it's okay. Like, and so we tell your friend like if your friend breathes on you and they have bad breath and like, do I have bad breath? You tell them you have bad breath, you know? And so you be honest with them because sometimes we have friends like they go get a new haircut, all right? Like a new haircut, and it kind of looks like they just stuck their head in a blender and like, hey, do you like my haircut? You're like, yeah, I love it. You know what I'm saying? Like that's what we do. So is it really okay to lie? It's like, I don't want to hurt their feelings. Well, listen, if you're their friend, you probably already have hurt their feelings at some point, and they probably hurt yours. So just tell the truth. Tell the truth, be honest, be truthful. Live a truthful life in all that you do because it's something that needs to happen. We need, listen to me, your generation, you need friends who are going to be true to you. You need friends that are gonna tell you the truth even when it hurts. Because you know, I've had friends in my life. I have friends even in this room where I've done something stupid and they're like, they tell me the truth, I don't like it. It's like, oh, I don't wanna hear that. I don't want to hear that, but because they're my friend, they're able to tell me the truth. When choosing someone to be in your like inner circle, try to pick someone who is honest and truthful with you. Look for friends who are genuinely honest. Sometimes you're going to have friends that are more honest than others. We all have people in our life that are like that brutally honest person where you're like, you're walking around and someone asks them a question and you just got to put the hand over the mouth. You know what I'm saying? Like, ah, nope, you're not talking. You're not allowed to say anything. You're not allowed to say anything. But you need to seek out friends that tell you the truth, even if it means that other people are going to talk about them or make fun of them. You need to strive to be the kind of friend that you desire to have. Check that out. Listen, I'm going to say it again. You need to strive to be the type of friend that you desire to have. So many times we have expectancy of everybody else, but not of ourselves. If you expect that your friends should act a certain way, you better be acting that way. Because we all need new friends. And we got to understand that lying is never good for anyone. Because I'm going to tell you what happens. Liars will lie to you, on you, and about you all the time. That's what liars will do. They will lie to you all of the time, and they will lie about you, on you, and they don't care about your reputation. They don't care about who you are. They're going to lie about you and on you. What do I mean on you? What I mean on you is when someone starts saying something, they throw lies on you to make you look bad. They place things upon you and on you that aren't even true. So we got to understand that we need new friends. We need friends that are going to tell us the truth. Why? Colossians 3:9 says this. Do not lie to each other, since you have taken off your old self with its practices. Meaning, don't be like you used to be. If you're in here tonight and you love Jesus and you've given your life to him and you're a Christian, then you don't live that way anymore. See, this whole thing about Christianity is living, I used to live this way, but now I live this way. I used to do these old things, but now I do the new things. So don't lie to each other since you've taken that off. Don't lie on each other. Don't lie about one another. If your friend is lying to you about you, then they're not really your friend. So we have to understand that. We have to get that, and we have to get that in our hearts, that if you're looking for new friends, these are the type of people that you're looking for, those that are loyal, those that are truthful. Number three is this. If something's going on in your life and it's crazy and they aren't there for you, that's a sign maybe. Yeah. Check this out. It's called backstabbing. How many of you ever heard of that? Backstabbing. You know, saying like, oh, hey, we're friends. And all of a sudden you turn around and do something and they stab you in the back because they aren't really there for you. They're hurting you. This is what I find. Check this out. Too many of our friendships are built around convenience. If one friend is always available and one is not, this becomes an unhealthy friendship, an unhealthy relationship. You need mutually beneficial friends that can both give. If you're always giving to your friend, and all they do is take, that's unhealthy. Put it this way. If all you did was take your friend's money all the time, like, hey, I need the money. They're going to go broke. And then they have nothing to give anymore. But yet you're spending the money and it's going out just as quick as it's going in. So you have nothing to offer them. When you have friendships and you're together, you need to understand that those things are important. Can I tell you what you don't do? What you don't do to someone, especially a friend that's having a hard time, you don't ever say, well, let me know if you need anything. That aggravates me. I'm being honest. If I'm going through a hard time, sometimes let me know if you need anything. I need a flight to Hawaii. I need to get out of here. I need $1 million. I need this. I need a Chick-fil-A sandwich. I need something to make me feel better. Like, do you really mean what you say when you say, let me know if you need anything? So many times we throw that out, like, you say that to your friend, you're like, hey, if you need anything, let me know. If you need anything, let me know. Can I tell you, your heart is definitely in the right place if you're saying this, because you're making yourself available, but you might not realize that what you're saying to that person, because what you're saying, this puts the burden on them that they're already going through a hard time. Now that you're like, well, I'm supposed to figure out what you're supposed to do for me. You know, if you have a friend that's going through a hard time, you know what you do? You don't say, hey, if you need anything, you go to the store. You get a bunch of ice cream. You go to their house. You kick open the door like Spartan kick it. Bring in the ice cream. Put it down and just go to town. Just go to town. If you don't say that you're going to do it, just do it. Your friend's having a hard time. They're struggling with something. Go grab your computer. Get Netflix. Get them. Drag them to the car. Go out somewhere. Put your computer or your iPad down and begin to watch Netflix and enjoy the time with them. Where I'm sick and tired of people saying, hey, I will do this for you and not do it. Because you know what this is equivalent to? How many times have you gone through something and someone says, oh, I'm praying for you? No, you're not. Don't tell me you're praying for me. You're not praying for me. We do it all the time, though. We do it all the time in the church. Oh, I'll pray for you. When people say that to me, you know what I said? All right now, let's do it. They're like, I want to pray for you right now here. I don't care if we're in the mall. I don't care if we're in Giant Eagle. I don't care where we are. You say you're going to pray for me? Let's pray right now. And when I'm around people and something comes up, if I say, hey, I'm going to pray for you, you better believe I'm going to pray right there. Because it's something that we just throw over. And something like, oh, just a Band-Aid. Oh, I'm just going to put this over just to make sure that you're okay. So if you need anything, boom, I'm just going to put this over. We all have had friends that have said this to us, but we need to be better than that. You need to ask specifically what is it going to do? What can I do? If someone says, hey, you know what, this or that. Well, you know what? Give me exactly what you need right now, and I can do this for you. Exactly what's going to happen. Because this is the problem, is we're not unconditional with each other anymore. We talk about unconditional love, but what about unconditional friendship? What about friendship that works through stuff? See, people who love you unconditionally are people who love you even when you don't look good. When you're having a bad day. When you cuss them out or flip out at them. When they come in and they're just having a rough day and everything's going wrong and they say things they don't mean, but you still love them. When you go to camp for a whole week and you're trapped in a dorm with them and everybody stinks, but you don't talk about how their stinkiness is the stinkiest one in the room. You don't talk about that. Why? Because you have this unconditional love for them. And you're saying, listen, like, unconditional love means there's nothing you're going to do that's going to stop me from loving you. And where do we get this? We get this because this is what Jesus says to us. Jesus says, I have an unconditional love for you that I want to show to you, that I want to give to you, that I want you to understand. Because without unconditional love, without faithfulness, without loyalty, without all of these things, it's just all we're doing is walking around blind. We're leading our friends blind. Check this picture out. Go ahead and put that picture up. Blind people leading blind people. The Bible says, let them alone. Their blind, their blindness guides them. It guides them. And if the blind lead the blind, both will fall. What does this mean? What does that do? Well, can I tell you, if there's not an unconditional, healthy relationship in your friendship, it's just like blind people leading blind people. It ain't going to go anywhere. You're not going to make it to where you need to be and where you need to go. What would it look like for a blind man to be behind the wheel of a sports car or a NASCAR flying down the road? He'd probably wreck within seconds. Within seconds. It's a scary. You ever take a road trip with someone who has no idea where they're going? You ever been in a car lost with somebody? You don't ever want to be in a car with me when I'm lost. Ever. Ever. I like Hulk smash. I go crazy. Road rage, it's like, it's insane because I hate being lost. But imagine like when you jump in a car, there's no road map, there's no GPS, there's no MapQuest, your phone's not working, there's no service. It's like guaranteed you're going to end up somewhere you don't want to be. When I lived in Kentucky, I first moved there for a year, this happened to me all the time. I'd end up somewhere where I shouldn't have been. I'm like, I don't know how I got here. But see, naturally, I'm like, oh, I'm just going to take a left. I'm going to take a right. I'm going to take a left. I'm going to take a right. And then I'm trying to get to my friend's house, and all of a sudden I'm lost in the middle of nowhere. And I'm in what's called a holler. Those of you who don't know what a holler is, it's an actual place. A holler in Kentucky is where all the families live together. And when you, as soon as you pull in, it's like if all of your family lived on the same block or on the same road. That's what a holler is. They all live there. They all know each other. And guess what? When an outsider comes rolling up, they know. I remember I came rolling up into the hall. Next thing I know, I hear, and I was like, what? They're like, can we help you? I was like, I'm lost. And he's like, let me help you out. Go back that way. Okay. All right. Directions. Like, I got to get somewhere. But let's check this out. This is what I want to get to. Going through life with someone who lives recklessly, who doesn't care, who does these things, who ditches you, who lies to you, and is not there for you. It's just like you being with someone who's blind leading you. Leading you places you shouldn't do, to do things you shouldn't do. Going places you shouldn't go, with people you should never be with. You need to choose the right friends, because you show me your friends, I show you your future. We hear that all the time, and we hear that as a saying, but that's the truth. That when you are around a group of people and they act a certain way, you will act that way. You will be that way. You'll kind of go that route. You can't go by how popular or how they dress or how they look. You need to go by what these things are. You need to have friends that won't ditch you, that are loyal. You need to have friends that are going to tell you the truth. But you need to have friends that are going to be faithful and be there for you unconditionally. Again, let me ask you, how many of you need new friends? It's okay to be honest. We need new friends, but we need to find and search for the things that we are searching for. We need to be those very things. Choosing the right friends is something that requires God's help. You cannot do it by yourself. You need to pray and ask God to say, God, I need some new friends. I need people in my life that are going to uplift me and build me up and be there. And you'll be surprised who that friend could be. You could end up being a friend with someone that you never knew could be a friend. You could end up being connected to someone that you never thought in a million years you'd be connected with. But it's one of these things where God will give you the friends that you need. God will give you these friends and bring them into your life. But these are just tonight three signs of a friendship, of friends, that if these are going on in your friendships, you're going to need new friends. Because these aren't healthy. They aren't good. They aren't wonderful. They aren't these things where are going to help you or benefit you. Because can I tell you the mark of a true friend? The mark of a true friend is someone that pushes you to Jesus. That's the mark of a true friend. Someone who pushes you to Jesus. If you're around people who are not pushing you to Jesus, where are they pushing you? Where are they pushing? If they're not pushing you towards Jesus, then where are they pushing you? Where are they taking you? Because they're either taking you to or away. That's pretty much it. That's how it goes. To or away. If they're not pushing you towards Jesus, they're probably pulling you away from him. I'm telling you from experience that sometimes we need to evaluate who our friends are. And it's hard when you've had friends that have been your friends for a long time, and you reach that point where you say, you know what? They're not good for me. But you know what we do so often? We have what's called the superhero syndrome, where we feel like we can save everybody. Well, we can be, oh, I can be around all these people and they do all this stuff and they party and they drink and I go to the parties all the time with them, I drink all the time with them and I smoke all the time with them, I do all these things all the time. And you know, I'm going because they need someone like me in their life. Well, you don't have to go to those things. You don't have to be involved with those things. You don't have to put yourself in those positions because it's a lot more likely that they're going to pull you down before you're ever going to pull them up. If I stand up here on top of this stage and I ask, and I have Jeremiah come up. Come here, Jeremiah. Come right here. Come right here. Down right in front of me, buddy. All right. So Jeremiah and I are friends. And I'm living this good life, and he's just a dirt ball. No offense. I love you. That's why I picked you. All right. Here, grab my hand. Now, for me as a Christian, I'm trying to pull him up out of his lifestyle. I'm trying to pull him up out, and I'm doing my best to get him up here with me living for God. But it's not working. But as soon as he begins to pull on me, it's going to go ahead and start pulling me. It's going to be a lot harder, and it's going to be difficult to stay up here with God and to live with God and to pull Jeremiah up with me where I'm at. It's going to be a lot harder to live a life, thank you. It's going to be a lot harder to live that life and pull my friends up there where I'm at. But that's what we try to do. We try to have this superhero syndrome. We're trying to save these people and bring them up to where they need to be. But on the whole, meanwhile, they're pulling us down to where we shouldn't be. Again, how many of us need new friends? I'm sure that most of us do. From the youngest to the oldest, we need friends that are going to push us towards Jesus. So the three signs that you might need new friends tonight is really number one is that these friends, they ditch you. They're not there for you. They don't help you. Number two is that they lie to you. Number three is that really, in a sense, they aren't there and they aren't conditionally there for you. They're only that, when things are good, I'm going to be there, but when things get bad, I'm leaving. No, it's an unconditional love that they have to stay in that relationship. In the next three more weeks, we're going to talk about friendship, and we're going to add to these signs, and we're going to add to these things and say, hey, if this is going on in your friendships, if this is going on in your relationships with who you are around, you need to get out of that. You need to get out of that. Jesus shows us how to be a friend because he was a friend to 12 disciples. He had 12 people that he brought close to him, and then he really just brought the three into his inner circle. So we have to understand that we are called to be a friend, but we have to be the godly friend that we desire. Bow your heads and close your eyes tonight.